It's Wednesday morning.
Yes, it is.
Welcome to Your View. I am Mariah Afolabi Brown. As always, I have my lovely co-host here. Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Hi, Takwe. How are you doing?
I'm very good. Nima is not in a good mood. People are assuming that she's not fasting.
Yeah, the cups.
She is fasting, and the cup is part of the props, and she feels concerned that people are doubting her integrity as a Muslim that is fasting.
No, the cup is part of the props of the show, so please put the cup there. Thank you very much. Let me jump to Nima. How are you?
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. How are you doing
there? From the first day of their fasting, we have always shown that her cup is empty.
Yeah.
I mean, then again, when you fast, it's between you and God. You don't need to show anyone.
Exactly.
Muslims are different. Personal.
No. It's personal. It's personal. Really. If anybody thinks they're stealing, that's
their business. Exactly.
Yeah,
I think.
Between you and God.
I saw it from home yesterday, and your view being upside down is not a good thing.
Yeah.
You know, you may just take away the cup. Anyways. I was resting yesterday. Mariah, guess what happened on Monday? I thought I've been feeling feverish. Oh, let me just go and take maybe paracetamol or something. And then I went to a pharmacy and I said, Oga, I have some pains here. I feel a little cold. He said, when was the last time you treated yourself for malaria? I looked. Last day. Anyways, the man gave me malaria drugs. I went to my two kids. Me, I like to read everything. And then I read the leaflet and I'm like, really? A pharmacist gave me this drug knowing that I'm a woman? He didn't even ask me questions. Are you breastfeeding? Are you planning to have a baby? The side effects of that drug is not right for a woman who is ready to have babies to have it. And I'm like, really? Women, please, don't go to a pharmacist for any drug. Go to your doctor first. Even if it is headache, let your doctor be the one to say, oh, yeah, go and buy this drug at the pharmacy. Come on.
I think you should have read the leaflet before taking the drugs.
So, well, I'm so sorry about that
I think that happens to me too. We have a news mention this morning. I don't want to spend on too much because actually I've experienced that recently. But the National Agency for Food and Drug Administration and Control, that's NAFDAC, has come out strongly warning us against the consumption of imported or smuggled frozen poultry meat. Even as it has said that the imported poultry products, especially chicken and turkey, have been discovered to be causative factors in non-communicable diseases and antibiotics resistance.
See,
English.
Let me just say it in plain English. Don't eat frozen chicken and turkey and all those gizzards. Now, every corner on my street, I have 3 people selling frozen chicken and gizzard. Every one of them imported. Every street, almost every street in Lagos, sell frozen chicken imported. And now they're saying that it has negative effects on our body. It can cause us to build resistance against antibiotics.
Let me explain
resistance against antibiotics.
Why do we eat frozen chicken? Is it that we're not able to produce enough chicken to feed Nigerians?
I need people to know the resistance. When they say resistance against antibiotics, it means that when you have cold, you take your drugs. It won't work. And then it keeps reoccurring. NAFDAC should go beyond warning us. You know where they are. They are on every street of Lagos.
Wait, listen now, Tokwe. It's cheaper than the live chicken. Frozen chicken
cheaper.
Is much cheaper. And it's easier to get.
Mariah.
When was the last time you actually killed chicken?
Wait.
So we all eat frozen chicken.
I don't eat that frozen one anymore. If the big departmental stores now sell live chicken made in Nigeria.
For real? We should let the man on the street go to those big departmental stores.
I think we should bring those departmental store kind of chicken into main circulation.
I think you guys are missing the point. Why is frozen chicken that is imported more cheaper? Why is it cheaper than...
Is it an economical crisis now?
Why is it cheaper than chicken produced in Nigeria?
Because
why do I have to buy...
Because I've seen the process of preserving them. I saw a video online that made me stop buying them because I used to stock them. The process of making it look big like a broiler chicken is by injecting a particular chemical into each part of the chicken. Not just, so it's cheaper to produce. They can always have, mass production of whatever, small chicken and just inject them, make them big enough for us to eat. It's cheaper than having to raise.
Or just eat fresh fish. Eat fresh fish.
That's all we can take. In fact, I'm just tired. What would you eat? You're not tired. That's all we can take on this banter. When we return, we'll look through the front pages of the newspapers. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Mariah, feeling good with her makeup.
Yes, I'm telling you, I'm feeling very beautiful this morning. I'm acting like Uwa is always feeling beautiful. All right, let's start with the punch. Oh, somebody warned me about this thing I did. APC senators fight as truce meeting fails again. Northern reps make a U-turn, mobilize against Gbajabia Mela. You can see the picture here. One of the senators doing waka. To another senator, Rishi Rishi. IG deploys 138 patrol vehicles to secure highways. Boko Haram kills 35 in Yobe and Borno. NNPC yet to remit $1.48 billion, says federal government. CBN stops forex sales to rice. Private jet importers also. Buhari vows to recover funds looted under Jonathan, says U.S. others will assist him. And finally, pro-panel, Wike Amaechi in war of words. All right, what's jumping at us here?
Of course, the APC police fight.
Oh.
That's the one that is jumping at me. Yeah, and but picture. It didn't. The truce meeting didn't fail, actually, as much as they didn't agree. Anyways, Senator Bukola Saraki had called the APC senators to say that go to your zones, zonal caucuses, and come out with the Senate leader, the deputy Senate leader, the chief whip, and the deputy chief whip. And one of the APC senators felt very angry that our APC chairman has already sent you a list of who these people are. You should just appoint them. Why should you then ask us to go back to the zones? And another senator who is loyal to Saraki came up and said, no, we are for, democracy. Merits and openness here. As much as the APC head has sent, let's go back to our zones. And then they disagreed.
Party, not chairman. Was the, the chairman wrote them a letter, but it was actually after the party had agreed.
Well, we must thank Saraki for waking up dead sleeping devils, because I don't understand the problem that he has. He has already gone against party policy to become the speaker. He should allow at least, you know, these people to be settled so that there will be peace within the party. Does he want to finally break down this party and we'll have a faction like we had in the PDP? Why did he send a list and insist on zoning when the party had agreed on who and who should be what?
See, my concern is, why would a single person's individual ambition in the bid to portray that person now destroy the entire good? Because, you know, as I remember the clip we showed a few weeks ago of 2013, how I was impressed with the coming together of APC, because we saw hope in APC. We voted for the change APC portends, but the reality of what is playing out in the Senate worries a lot of Nigerians, myself inclusive.
Yes. Now, what I just had a question.
I know that we want internal democracy, we want there to be political association, they should clarify it, but the political structure, that the party is stronger than an individual, and the party has nominated someone. Why are you causing quarrel?
Excuse me, I did not vote the party structure. I voted for the senators. Okay. All right. I have a question. Should it be the party that is determining the leaders or the caucuses? If you are party members, you have decided in your party whatever you have decided, then come to the Senate and be allowed to decide that, okay, oh, based on party decision, based on who we have also chosen in our caucus. I think Saraki is doing the right thing. And even if he did otherwise, he'll be saying that it is Oyegun who is picking people for him. Now, they have all decided together in their party. He came to the floor and said, go to your zones and decide. You people just go ahead to your zones and decide who the party decided.
And they can even, God bless you, they can even decide exactly who the party wants. But just make it look as if there was a process.
Merit and democracy.
Okay. All right, the nation, moving on forward. Cash crisis. Buhari vows to recover stolen billions. U.S. orders to support action. Over $2 billion in excess crude account. National Assembly, Oyegun writes Saraki Dogara on APC's position. And you can't miss this picture of this crowd. You think they're in the airport, but no. They are a crowd of job seekers in search of legislative aids jobs, scrambling for legislators' attention at the lobby of the National Assembly. So they're looking for jobs. All of them there. Say, hey, Oga Senator, Oga, please, I'm here, please, legislator, please.
Chokwe told me something in the makeup room that some senators allegedly that they don't pay their aides. Because I was saying, why are people flocking the National Assembly for jobs? Shouldn't this, legislators come with their own aides, from their zones? Mm. And she's like, no, some of them don't pay. So these people just come and just get the job. Two years, you're not getting paid by your Oga, but you're getting sidekicks.
That's her own version. You don't sure. You don't know that for a fact. Moving on to Vanguard. Buhari blows hot, vows to recover all stolen. Oh, it's Sun. I do apologize. So let me start with Sun. Oshiomhole on State of the Nation. Oil sector rotten. Jonathan was not prepared for leadership. Why states are broke. Robbers kill Lord's chosen pastor. Yay. I want to quit, says freed Ondo regent. I'll recover all loot, says Buhari. Give states lifeline to pay salary arrears. Okay, what are we talking here?
I'd like to take the human angle story. It interested me. Although, I also like that Governor Oshiomhole went to Daily Sun in Abuja and was saying to them that the last government wasn't ready at all for governance, or and that the oil, that by the time this government starts to uncover all sorts of things that went on in the oil industry, it will blow our minds. But Lord's chosen pastor, he went to a bank. He was trailed by guys on a motorbike, and they came at him, shot at him, made sure that he died, and fled with 3 million naira that he had on him. Now, somebody from the church was saying that he thinks that the staff of the bank may have done this because he called them ahead, so they knew he was coming to collect money. Somebody else, also from the church, is saying that no, it's because the GO of the church loves him very much. He's in charge of building, you know, in the Lagos State parish, and that his role is a very juicy one, that a church member may have assassinated him.
Too
much speculation. However, I feel that we need to go, the cashless policy is still the best way. And we are carrying 3 million naira, get a bullion van. Get a bullion van.
Okay.
3 million that you just carry in one small handbag. That's bullion van to carry how much?
Vanguard. Buhari blows hot, vows to recover all stolen funds. Says last administration worse than Second Republic. Days of impunity, of lack of accountability, recklessness over. U.S. other countries to assist in funds recovery. Bailout for states coming from excess crude account. You can see the picture here of all our president, the vice president, and the other governors. Uproar in Senate, House of Reps over leadership positions. How I was chained, tortured in the bush by my kidnapper, says Ondo Regent. And federal government states others owe construction companies 600 billion naira, says FOCI. Right.
Ondo Regent of Akungba Akoko was, you know, just recounting how she suffered with under her kidnappers. And she said, because it was the story, I finished it in the Sun, that she doesn't want to be regent anymore. They should appoint a ruler for the kingdom, for her kingdom, so she can, you know, go back to her family in Lagos and all that. That she's just tired, that they've been at it since 2013, and the things that she has gone through being regent, you know, she couldn't continue with them.
I feel really concerned because the experience was really, really gruesome, and
they led her into a forest for hours. You know, they tortured her.
They didn't give her food.
Oh, goodness me. No, these people, I don't know. Honest, Baba, please come on.
Let me just link it with Oshiomhole. Oshiomhole has instituted a law within Edo State that if any kidnapper is caught, it is going to be, I think there is that death sentence for every kidnapper, and they said kidnapping reduced almost like to next to nothing. I think every state should implement it. Kidnapping shouldn't be a cheap way to make money. We should discourage it in every form.
Our last paper for this morning. You can see the picture here. This picture actually covered our own governor. That the one in Vanguard did not cover our government. And he's the only one wearing a suit. That's Ambo. He really had today. All of them are wearing their Baba regards and all represent. Like, you know, I'm a technocrat.
I'm ready to
work. I'm a technocrat. I'm ready to work. I'm here for serious business.
You know your passion.
All this.
Friday, all of us were wearing Baba regards. Yes, now. Wearing a suit.
Yes, the man was like, I'm ready for work. All this is your Baba, your cap, and you're please, I'm ready to work. So we like the way you are representing us in Abuja. All right, let's read the headlines. We will recover funds stolen by government officials, says Buhari. IG deploys 158 patrol vehicles to highways. Pakistan declares heat wave emergency as death toll tops 450. APC crisis over National Assembly leadership deepens. Buhari. I know you talk about Buhari, but this heat wave thing, we are used to heat in this part.
No, not that kind of heat.
No, you've never had that kind of heat.
God forbid.
the one that it seems like the sun is coming on your head.
You won't even be able to survive it.
Ah, Mariah, that they are pouring water on their heads every second. Screaming. Ah, they've lost over 700 people.
Oh my God.
I beg that one. We don't want it in Nigeria.
It happened in America, and the Americans were screaming like they were.
Because I remember I was in the US, and there was heat wave. And I'm like, what is this?
You know, but when you have heat wave and you can quickly run into a building and there's AC, or you run into your car has AC, in the situation here is different, you know. So it's a natural disaster. We should just pray for them that God help them. But I want to talk about the IGP, that's the Inspector General of Police, deploying the cars, because we read in the papers 2 days ago that the President Muhammadu Buhari, has declared that all the military should leave roadblocks and that the police should take over. I'm impressed, because you see, we need to trust our police officers. That's their job. The police officer should be empowered to secure internal. No, what I'm saying is the job of the police officer is supposed to secure internal crisis, and then the military should fight the external ones, the terrorism.
Now,
within every instruction, we hear a lot of instructions. People just say, "Well, this is done." Every time our president gives instruction, you see action taking place within the next 2 days. Now we already have 158 deployed to secure.
Is that what is impressing you?
Yes.
Okay.
That she should be happy that finally there's
we're having police empowerment.
One at a time, we can't hear
We don't have a joint force, whatever they used to have. The police is doing the police work and the army is doing army work.
So if they ask me for 29, I shouldn't give them.
Don't give them.
Okay. I'll tell them they should go to the bar, to the checkpoint.
Don't give them. You can refuse. I refuse all the time.
All right. On that note, we end front page review. When we return, empty treasury and unpaid salaries. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. President Muhammadu Buhari recently decried that his new government is battling to reshape Nigeria, saying he made an almost empty treasury and huge debts left behind by his predecessor. At his first meeting since his inauguration 3 weeks ago, the president said it was embarrassing that the situation has degenerated to a situation where federal and state governments cannot pay their workers. The empty treasury and the declining economy left by the previous administration, saying Nigeria should be in a better position than it is now. What are your thoughts on this? To give us your view, you can call us on 070-8066-8014. You can tweet to us at YourViewTVC. All right, there have been different angles to this story. Oh, we already knew there was an empty treasury before they left. Knew there was no money. And part of your campaign was saying that you are still going to take us out of this mess. So, what's the lamentation about?
I even have a personal grout. What's the grout? Grouse against the president. Now, when he was saying that, I'm not going to go after looters from May 28th downwards, I was saying, is it that this man doesn't know that the way they are spending money for this campaign right now, the treasury is going to be empty. Then when I now saw, I met empty treasury yesterday in the papers, I'm like, tell us something new, Olga. You know? But it's a good thing. If somebody has stolen our national wealth, we should go after them. One, that is deterrent against other people from doing it. Secondly, we need the money.
Well, I love the fact that even though he wanted to be a peaceful man, the realities on ground now staring him in the face has made him make a U-turn that is most, you know, wise right now. With the transition committee report and the transition committee chairman saying that, you know, there's so much corruption everywhere, there's no how the president will be, you know, will have that report in front of him and not say that he will go after, you know, looted treasury. Apart from the fact that we have an empty treasury, looted money that, you know, he knows that with what he has in front of him, he has to react.
Should our government focus on chasing these people, or actually just, no, we just want to see governance.
From the action of the president, you see, it wasn't a decision. He didn't focus on, you know, chasing anybody. It happened that we are broke and we need our monies back. That is why he's doing it. This is what is in front of me. This is what is glaring.
I think good governance can be defined as sustaining the country, and right now is the clear fact is we cannot sustain the country as it is. So getting the looters, yes, is good governance. It's not, that's not contravening the is focus, if you focus on, it's prioritized it well. It's been dealing with insecurity. I still feel concerned that Boko Haram is still having
a field day,
sort of. But we know that it's concentrating on insecurity, and now it wants to concentrate on the economy, because the second agenda is to create employment. You cannot create employment where you have your most of your states, 18 out of your 36 states cannot afford to pay salaries. Mm. You know, so we can't move on to the next level. But, so money recovery is very, very important.
Yeah,
I feel that it sounds that the media seem to be blowing everything the president says out of proportion. Honestly, every word, I wish I was the president when I was younger, after I became the governor, and he said, oh, the president is weak, the president is saying, he's giving excuses.
He has asked for their
every
support
word of the president is being misconstrued.
Let me take Eric's call. Good morning, Eric.
Good morning.
Yes, sir.
My name is Eric Sulere. First time caller.
Yay.
Well, I have to commend Jumoke. You are looking great.
Oh, thank you.
I love your dreadlock.
Thanks.
Yeah, I want to talk on the APC problem. They are talking about this one, the CACOS coming up with social person. It is not supposed to be so. It is very, very wrong. This is a democratic era. If there should be somebody to be picked, let it be done in the House, just like the APC, just like the senators did their voting inside the House. It is not all about one person being selfish. Just the APC leaders coming up with their own leader saying that they want to bring up this person. If they are doing it that way, it is not going to help this nation.
Mm.
I support what, yeah, just like the notion that Ben Moribruz is coming up. If they are picking somebody, let it be from the House. Mm. It is not of some people going on into one corner and picking up somebody. It is not going to help the nation.
Thank you so much.
Mariah, two concerns. We're going after Treasury looters with who? Nigerian judiciary?
Mm.
We've seen different committees set up in the past and nothing came out of them. Because even the NJC has said that they have some compromised judges in the system. So if somebody who we say stole 1 billion calls the judge on his case and says, you know what, I'll give you 100 million out of this amount, and the case dies, as we have seen in the past, what happens? So is the president first and foremost going to make sure that the judiciary is empowered?
I'll go back to his inaugural statement when he was being inaugurated. Part of that statement included the fact that he acknowledged the fact that they needed to strengthen the judiciary, that the system that they put in place to ensure that it's not the president's problem to be concerned about corruption, because the system would sort that matter out.
Let me take Mrs. Juru's call from Agbara. Good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, you are looking lovely.
Thank you.
Yeah. Please, I want to appreciate her, Jumoke. I listen to what she says. But I want to make a correction here. Please, you should withdraw that statement that this...
Sorry? Oh, man, I wanted to hear that. Withdraw which statement?
Well, I want to quickly correct something Jumoke said, that we have corrupt judges everywhere. The law is about rules and rules. A judge wants to bail out a corrupt leader, he has to follow the rules. So if there is no window to let that leader go, it won't go, because you know there's no such window in the laws made by the legislators, not the judges.
Hmm.
The judges are made, you know, that their own is to implement these laws while, you know, prosecuting cases and judging cases. It's not all the time that you see judges getting away with any of these things. The NJC is there to look into it, whether rules were followed to get to a
sometimes
judgment.
Sometimes these rules are followed, but yeah, we've seen
I want to bring an example. Cecilia Ibru got away because the law at the time made it allowed the judge to pass to give a fine.
Farouk.
We had the issue of the police pension thieves getting away with 250,000
because
the act in question, you know, that was supposed to order which he was charged allowed such to happen. Now when a judge uses that act without, you know, with selfish reasons, the NJC can then look into it that okay, you had a punishment, why didn't you put and fine and
Farouk,
you know,
Lawana,
the fine and the punishment together and the prison sentence together, why take only that? The NJC would look into it, but not all the time that you have, you can say that all judges are corrupt.
Farouk.
There's so many cases.
He wrote it out. It's still in court. We've just not heard anything about it recently because government is government.
Okay.
But not the judges. You know, you can't just place it at the door.
Okay, all right. But let's not refocus our discussion because what the focus is the fact that our president said, I have an empty treasury. Mm. Now, the state has said, I can't pay my salaries. Mm. There's talk about them sharing the excess crude given to the state. Now, if that happens, we now really have an empty treasury. What is now the way forward? Like, I mean, how do we now fix this problem?
You know, when I read that statement that they were going to share the remaining, because you know, what brought us to this problem was the fact that they were sharing everything. Now we want to share the last, like our last thread.
Let me take Ayodele's call. Good morning, Ayodele. Are you there?
Yes. Good morning.
Morning. Please go ahead.
First of all, let me correct one question. Hello?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead, please.
Yes. The party has the right to select who will be their principal officer in the house. Because every individual in the party has to not trust the whole thing.
I'm having trouble hearing your idea. I so sort of apologize. It's very blurry. So sorry about that. We couldn't hear him.
Okay, right. I was saying that the excess crude oil account, I feel concerned that we're not planning for the future generation, as in there is no apparent, clearly defined plan that we're working towards to achieve preservation of our future.
Let me hear Jumoke on this matter.
Excess crude accounts were set up for this kind of crisis, when the country is in total chaos.
Or when the oil prices drop like that.
Everything, so you have some money saved away. Because listen, the people who are being owed 8 months salary, they don't care about the future. They're present, they're dying presently. So you need to bail those people out right now. If you have to share that money, and then in future, save whatever you earn from whatever resources you're selling out.
Let me take George's call. Good morning, George, are you there?
Good morning, Mariah.
Please go ahead, thanks for calling.
And to all the ladies there.
Good morning.
Yeah, Jumoke, I always flow with your sound reasoning.
Permit
me to disagree with your view this morning on the Senate issue. You see, the party APC has the manifesto, and they are duty bound to implement that manifesto before the electorate. The promises they make, they have to fulfill it. So that is the reason why they must have interest on those that are to be in sensitive positions in the legislature. Take, for example, Sarapi, who is now asking people to go to the caucuses in order to conduct elections among themselves. He himself defied electoral process in his party. And I have not heard him speak one word about anti-corruption since he was elected. This is the concern of the party. If you do not whip people into place, you will not be able to fulfill the promises you made to the people. So I am for decency in electoral processes. But when you have an objective in every direction in order to achieve that objective, I can tell you, you just watch out. Before you know it, the real objective of APC, the legislature is going to frustrate it with this stubbornness that they are displaying. That's my concern.
Superior so argument.
Think about it.
I agree with you, sir.
Yeah.
I totally agree with him. I was just saying that, I mean, if we have agreed in the party, let's then come out and do what the party has said, you know, well,
he's not making a case for why the party must insist. Because they have
an objective
for the people.
But then again,
let
the will of the people supersede whatever it is that you want to do. For instance, in Ekiti, the people chose fire and share, regardless of what everyone else thinks. Yes. That's who they want. Yes. Then let them have their cup of tea.
Because ABC has our mandate right now. Yeah. And they have to ensure that they deliver the
superior argument. I totally agree from that point of view.
So we need to watch and monitor this and see how that goes. Yeah. Let's take a quick break. When we come back, we're still going to talk about this empty treasury and unpaid salaries, but now with an expert who's going to help us and direct this conversation to tell us how this happened and what are the solutions to this problem. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Yes, welcome back. No fewer than 12 of the 36 states of the Federation are still facing difficult times as the salaries still being owed to workers hit about approximately 110 billion naira. What are the possible solutions to getting these salaries paid? Joining us to enlighten us is an insurance broker and a financial analyst, Mr. Bestman Abumiri. Welcome to the show, sir.
Good morning. Good morning to viewers.
It's always a pleasure having you on because you always give us various insights on this, when the state of the economy and all that. Now, we've been hearing all sorts of options on, they are sharing excess credit accounts. We want bailouts. We don't want to do bailouts. Just pay what you owe us so we can pay our salaries. What's your take on all these versions of how to get monies paid to the state? And what do you even think caused it in the first place?
Well, I think the profligacy of the various state governors is responsible for the financial mess they found themselves and their respective states. Exactly. You know, I've said it in the past in this program that the satellite is always beamed on the president alone, or the presidency, if you like, without taking the state governments and their governors into consideration. They are the worst profligate managers we've seen in recent times. We thought when the military were around, they were probably our Achilles heel, but we have since found out that it parts into its significance when you take into consideration the attitude, the financial recklessness of the various state governors, maybe with the exception of one or two of them. Anambra is a good example. Akpabio is also a good example, even though I was hearing surprisingly that they probably owed 1 or 2 months' salary. Perhaps something was responsible for that because they had no business owing at all. I think that Anambra, Peter Obi managed that state for 8 years. And when he completed his tenure, information had it that he left about 70 billion in the coffers of Anambra State. And then when Obiano came in, he had no problem with continuity, or he didn't have to go to any media house to shout that, look, I met an empty treasury. And if you talk of developmental strides, Peter Obi is one of those governors that have been pointed at as having achieved a lot while in the office. So that is my perspective to why the mess the state governors have found themselves in their various states.
You blame mismanagement, I raised it some few days ago, I think last week on the show, that if you now offer bailout to these governors who probably mismanaged the previous ones given to them, how would you ensure that the ones they get as bailout isn't going into their pockets or into some contracts that are inflated?
Absolutely. I'm happy you are mentioning that, because information that filtered out from the meeting they said they held with the president has it that one of the options being considered is to ask for the money they spent on constructions in their various states of the Federation. If my experience about the construction industry is anything to go by, you find out that where such projects were even executed, they were executed haphazardly. They are not of standard nature. That is one. Two, they are 3 times
inflated.
I think some time ago, either last year or so, a comparative analysis was done on the contracts that are awarded by various governments in this country and other countries. It was found out that we pay 3 times the amount other country pays for better quality job.
Interesting. Now, sir, I want to bring you all into the fact that, yes, the state governments are definitely responsible. They can be held liable for the areas.
Yes.
But our president now is saying, there's empty treasury also. So the federal government too, also, how do they even spend this money? Because the government is saying, the state government is saying, they didn't give us the allocation, so we didn't get what the money was supposed to get. So what happened to that money in the treasury?
That is not correct. I remember Osun State is a good example. when Arebesola cried foul that they are owing them, that Okoye Wella did not release the state's money, what Jalili, the immediate past Minister of Police Affairs, did was to go to the Ministry of Finance and the Central Bank and brought out all the allocations. I didn't hear him talk again. He could not contradict the figures. It was discovered that the state was not being owed a kobo. You see, I take most of the politicians, if not 100% of them, I take whatever they say with a pinch of salt. The gullible Nigerians who wants to continue to buy into their lies can, but people like us cannot be deceived.
Sir.
Yes.
What are the state houses of assembly then doing?
They are made rubber stamps. You know it. So they are made rubber stamps because they benefit from the spoils of whatever we are talking about here. Once the governor settles them, they keep quiet. Yeah. Whatever,
so
you
should
know,
we share?
Mr. Governor is always right.
Yes. The problem is it not that the fact that we created some states that we know they are not economically viable, they cannot stand on their own. And the solution now would be to merge them with states that, you know, closer to them that are viable economically.
We some of us, it may not be here, in different fora, but I think in Radio Continental, on the occasions I've been opportune to talk there, we've said that, one, if you say you are a federating nation, there are things that are on the exclusive list that should be removed and bring to the current list. And one of those is the extractive industries.
Sure.
Why can't the governors collaborate and sponsor a bill to the National Assembly asking for that exclusive list to be looked at, to be reviewed, and make sure that things that will enable them to diversify their economies on their own. For example, if I have bitumen in my state, I'm a state governor. The federal government has no business coming to exploit the bitumen in my state. All I need to do is, if I don't have local experts that will help me explore and exploit the mineral, turn it into a usable product, all I need to do is to go to overseas, bring in technical partners, do this thing. Tell me why on earth Nigeria should be importing bitumen.
Please, I want to talk about, I want to ask you a question. Yes. Now, the resolution from yesterday's meeting that's between the president and the governors is that they would use the excess crude account to pay
salaries.
The salaries that are being owed. I feel concerned about that. But what do you think we should exhaust our excess crude account in order to pay for the salaries?
Do we learn from our past?
Going forward.
Hopefully, we're hopeful.
Please.
We do not learn from our. You see, any nation that does not save for the rainy day when you have surplus is bound to experience what is going on now. And that is the situation we have found ourselves. Much as I would say Okonjo Iweala was not the best finance manager or economic manager we could have had, you cannot take it away from her, because when the prices of crude oil was up there,
she said
save for the rainy day. The governors went to the media. They said, oh, this is not the constitution. What you are doing is unconstitutional. If you don't give us our money, if you don't share the money, we will go to the Supreme Court to nullify whatever policies you are making.
Sir.
And they had their way, and they shared the money.
Let me take this call.
So what did they do with the money? That's the question we should be asking.
Good morning, Banko. Are you there?
No, Abba. Good morning, my
Abba, I do apologize. Please go ahead.
No problem. Good morning. I greet all of you.
Yeah, my money.
What is happening now? We know, all of us, we know. Mm-hmm. When they're stealing, well, 40 billion is missing, and they go borrow 1 million, say they want to take and work for this country. We know this thing is coming. But if at that time PDP win, all this time, this story will not go here. Because new government is coming in. That's why we know all this thing is going. Because this thing is going in Nigeria. Please, let them make you do anything, make you settle the problem on ground, and they make you investigate the loophole, past governors, and the other senators and the other people. Please.
Yes, I agree with the idea of looking into the financial malfeasance of the various state governors, ministers, commissioners, etc., etc. But I do not agree with him that we are just knowing about the profligacy of the governors now. Even when PDP was in power, a lot of us who are discerning enough did raise questions about the recklessness of political office holders, not just the government. Okay.
So we know the long-term solutions. Oh, make us get our resources or minerals into the recurrent list, or get the governors to be more independent. On this. You know, we already know what to do at the long term. What's like the immediate thing? Aside from this sharing of the excess crude, what can we do to ensure that we have the salaries are not paid, as paid, pretty much?
Well, I heard in the news this morning that by May, they'll be releasing their due allocations to them. I think the question that should agitate our mind is that, are the political office holders being owed?
We have asked it.
What of the retinue of cars that the governors will take about wherever they are going to? Do you know what it takes to fuel a car? I know you drive a car. Don't you know how much you spend on daily basis to fuel a car, or every 2 days, depending on your activities? So they need to cut costs. One, in Bauchi, we heard sometime last year or two that governor had, or was it Gombe, up to about 900 or 1,000 political office holder aides that were working for him.
Why?
What job are they doing?
Let me take Yakub's call, sir. I have to take Yakub. Good morning, Yakub. Are you there?
Please
join this conversation.
Yeah, thank you. And a good morning to you again. And then about this very particular question, and the guys in the studio have already do the justice to the matter. The question is that, but one thing me I want that Mr. President should do is that to go after all those looters. You should make sure you recover all our money. But let me just say something about Saraki issue, please. Even though George from Ikeja, I think so, is already saying my mind to Jumoke. And then I always respect Jumoke's opinion every time. But this point, I also disagree with her totally. Why am I saying that? You could remember that Saraki has ambition. If that Saraki doesn't have ambition, why can't Saraki go to own his own caucus to go and hold meeting before he becomes a Senate president? And then, mind you, Saraki does not run under independent candidacy. He runs under political party. He should respect political party. If we give him go ahead to be doing all what he's doing now, come 2019, if Saraki runs on an independent candidacy, can he be a Senate president? It can never be.
See, right.
Saraki should respect political party, and that political party know best to do for their party in order to fulfill the promise to Nigerians.
Thank you very much. So, you said, you've, okay, let me let you.
In the long run, we rebased our economy last year by the last past administration, and we had other avenues where money could come from aside oil, which was how we based it and said it was the largest economy in Africa. What can we do to make sure that those other areas, because we know funds were put into, like Nollywood, for instance, funds were put into these areas. How can we make sure that we can reap some profit from them and benefit the masses?
Well, let me take that off. First and foremost, Nollywood. The films they are making, do they pay royalty to the government so that we can get some accruals from what was invested into them? I didn't see anything wrong with what the government did. The issue of piracy have not been sufficiently dealt with. That must be dealt with, and they must be made to pay their taxes. Royalties must accrue to the government. That is one. Two, agriculture was well managed. Those who were saying that there was nothing good about the agricultural policy of the immediate past government will now eat their words, without which Adesina would not have been elected as the president of ADB presently.
True.
You understand? I think we need consolidation in that area. The extractive industry is an industry that is lying comatose. We can get a lot of benefit from the extractive industry. The construction industries, take Lagos here for example. Apart from the open roads we see, go to the inner roads. If the local governments are left with their funds alone, and they are also contributing their quota. Do you know the construction industry can employ a lot of people? And it's also a way of diversification, diversification of the economy.
Right.
There are a lot of things we can do outside oil.
Okay, let me take this call money. Very quickly. Hello, I think Daddy Doi, I believe, or Doi.
Yes, it's from Ikorodu.
Morning, please, go ahead.
Good morning.
Morning.
Yes. First, I want to say this. Concerning the issue of the role of APC as regards the leadership of the National Assembly, it is what is expected of any responsible party that is visionary and has something to deliver for its people. Because if you have a black sheep, a black leg, in the course of your pursuing your purpose and objective for the citizens,
okay,
that is bound to be in crisis.
Let me cut you real quick, because that's not our focus, but everybody keeps driving us to that place. So I'd like you to mention, because you said the legislators are like mere rubber stamps.
Yes.
Let's connect this now. Everybody's talking about the leadership in the House, the Senate. What are your comments on this?
You see, as far as I'm concerned, those who are saying that the legislators should toe party line, I'm not saying they should be a destabilizing force to their various political parties. For God's sake, after the presentation of your candidates, you sponsor them, not necessarily because you gave them money. They brought out their various money to contest elections and won. Your domineering, you know, attitude stops there. For God's sake, let us copy from other nations. In U.S., I've not had Republicans or Democrats prying into what they are doing in the Congress.
Thank you, sir.
Let them elect the leaders they think can lead them aright. And then, of course, that will give them the independence to be able to challenge the executive whenever they are doing wrong, or support them.
But
whenever
don't you buy the argument?
A positive cause.
Don't you buy the argument that APC has our mandate? So the leaders are trying to ensure that objective, the promises they made to us as citizens, they can achieve those promises once they have the right people in place.
What is your own concept of right people?
Exactly. Who are the wrong people?
Is it by choosing people and imposing people on them?
Exactly.
Well,
I don't buy it.
I have a call for Madam Mawa. It's a long distance call. Good morning. Are you there?
Yes.
Please go ahead.
Morning, madam.
Morning, sir.
Salam alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. Walaikum.
What are you? My contribution is this. Please, APC should try to come together, because we suffer and then we commit a lot of force for them.
That's all.
We really work and work for them. Please. And we always pray for them. And for Nigeria. Thank all you very much.
Okay, let's take them to it.
Romy Ima says, if indeed the treasury is empty, where did the FAAC get the 419 billion naira May allocation to share? More politics than reality. Tola Olatoni said about the unpaid salaries. One, they should reduce the cost of governance, and everybody in GEJ regime should be probed. FX Stoney said the invited guests has said it all. Shehu says, as simple as ABC. Empty treasury bar, and thank God they are still alive. EFCC should go after them and bring back our money. Nasser Abdul said EFCC should be put to work to recover our stolen funds from the looters, which they must obey without ration.
I have a question, not a tweet exactly. Yes. So how can we reform our education system to ensure that we bring out, instead of job-seeking graduates, to bring out entrepreneurs who can actually employ people?
That's the topic for another day. I don't want us to go that far. I would like him to respond to those tweets, because that's the whole new kind of worms. Yes.
Yes.
Different.
One more. Yeah. Ezia Maka says, the oil in the oil-producing states is the reason why the federal government will not allow states to control their natural resources.
There's another question. Tajude Mbalogun says, ask your guest if past government had any role in salary chaos.
Yes, of course.
Past government. Some of the governors are the ones in focus here. Some of them are still serving. They've not served out their tenure.
True.
And they are part of those who are looking for bailout. See, it is not everything we can say on air. We have privileged information of what goes on in various states, but let's just leave that. I mean, leave those things as they are. The point is this. they are part and parcel. And the idea of saying GEJs, look, I was seeing a screaming headline this morning saying that Jonathan's government is worse than Shagari's regime. I beg to disagree. Shagari's regime foisted on us the inflation and economic adversity we are still experiencing till today. We've not been able to recover from it. Then Babangida came and compounded the entire problem. So if they want to settle down and do their job, I'm not saying that, look, I hope they know that we are in a democratic dispensation and nobody can do anything by fiat.
Yes.
We bringing back looted money will take some time.
Mm.
Like I said on air in one of the radio stations yesterday, I said, who is that going to probe who?
Okay.
Because the judiciary,
yes,
the executive, and the legislator, excluding the present president,
Everyone has all been there before.
I think that's all we can take because
who's still in just said everything that
thank
said.
You so much, Steph, for always being. We appreciate your being here.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the program. Don't forget to watch a repeat broadcast at 11:30 p.m. tonight. God bless you. See you tomorrow. Bye bye.